We are beginning a new series here. We're gonna spend a little time in the book of Daniel. I don't know how many weeks, but at least a couple, three or four. We'll see how that goes. I would invite you, if you're looking for a Bible study or a devotional here in the next few weeks, that maybe crack open that Bible and turn to that book and read along with me, and we'll talk about several of the things inside of that book. I think one of the descriptions of the book of Daniel is it can really be viewed as a book of hope. And I thought that was kind of a nice segue from last week, because one of the last statements that we talked about from our bylaws that we shared here during last week's message was our belief in hope. We are a people of hope. It's a key attribute of being a follower of Christ, that we're people of hope. Things that we look forward to that we've not seen yet, that we believe are good. The things that are yet to come. And that's kind of where the book of Daniel is set. The setting of the book of Daniel, it really takes place at a time and a place where the people were at a low, a very low. The people of God, Israel, was at one of their darkest times. They were lost, they were desperate, and they needed encouragement. And the story then of Daniel came at a time to provide just that for people that just so needed to hear a good word and to be encouraged by hope. They needed to know at that point that who they worshiped, the God that they worshiped, was still in control, that his kingdom would be established, his rule and his reign would come, and that would be accomplished through them, because that's who they were to be. The people of Israel knew that they were God's chosen people to carry out just that, to bring God's kingdom to the world and to make God known to all the world. And there then would have been this desire for where these people were there and then to get back to the way things were, to get back to a lifestyle and the way of living that they would have been used to. They're in a place, I think, then that isn't so far from where you and I are. You know, they wanted to get back to the good old days. And you hear that a lot. You know, with the things that are going on in our culture, in our country, and throughout the world. We just wish we could get back to the way things used to be. Back where we believe things were better. At least they seemed better. And, you know, we look around and we see some of the things in our world, the behaviors of people, the immorality that is in our cultures, the gods that are being served, different gods than the one we knew, idols like money and power and sensuality that seems to be so prevalent throughout our world. There's another way of life, another kind of culture that we'd like to get back to. And so I think that makes us in a similar situation of the people of Daniel's time, that they wanted to get back. They wanted to get back to a way of life. And you hear some of that in our culture today. We just wish we could get back. So I'm going to read through the first chapter here of Daniel. We'll kind of break this down and walk through it a little bit. I will butcher some names, but I'll ask for forgiveness now, just because some of these are hard. In the third year of the reign of King Jehoiakim of Judah, King Nebuchadnezzar of Babylon came to Jerusalem and besieged it. The Lord let King Jehoiakim of Judah fall into his power, as well as some of the vessels of the house of God. These he brought to the land of Shinar and placed the vessels in the treasury of his gods. So just a little bit of background here. The year is about 587 B.C., 6th century B.C. And if you remember, Israel was this nation, and it was 10 or 12 tribes of people that made up Israel. And they were given this promised land, and they were to do and to be God's people. Well, 150 so years before this, the northern 10 tribes get all busted up from Assyria. They're taken to captivity, and they're scattered. They're already gone. And so there's just this two tribes that formed Judah in the south. And they had been there for a while, but now Nebuchadnezzar from Babylon has come. He's waged war against this country, and he's destroyed the rest of Israel. couple other books in the Old Testament talk a little bit about how this took place. In 2 Kings, it talks about Nebuchadnezzar. He carried all the treasures from the house of the Lord and the treasures of the king's house. He cut into pieces all the vessels of gold in the temple that King Solomon of Israel had made. All of that stuff had been tore up. Jeremiah speaks of this as well in chapter 52. He said, Nebuchadnezzar came and he burned down the house of the Lord, the temple. And all of the big homes within Judah he had burned down. The pillars of bronze, you can see one of them that's there in the front of the picture there. That was all made out of bronze. He tore those down and he took away the bronze that was there. The bronze sea, lower left-hand corner, that was that great big basin surrounded by 12 ox that were all made out of brass. He tore those up and he took the bronze back to Babylon. All of the things that would have been used in worship, if you remember how they did that, the sacrificial system, all the pots and pans and shovels and meat pokers and all that stuff that they had to do there was made out of brass and gold and silver. All of that stuff was taken and broken by Nebuchadnezzar and taken back to Babylon to be used for other things. What's interesting here is at the very center, the upper, kind of middle left there, I don't know if you can see it real well, but remember those two cherubim, those horsey-looking things that are there, and right in the middle of those is the Ark of the Covenant. Remember that? The box, and inside of there were the Ten Commandments. Remember that? What's interesting is that we don't know about that. Was it taken away? We don't know. It's not mentioned here. And you'd think the most central piece of the Jewish worship would have been mentioned here, that it was taken away. And that makes the big mystery. They don't know where that is. So they made the movie Raiders of the Lost Ark to tell you where it was. You know, they made that up. But it's interesting that wasn't mentioned there. But all that stuff was taken away. So we sort of see why these people at the time that Daniel would have written this, Daniel's one of these, we'll find out that was taken away and he's in Babylon. The other people that were there, they knew what they lost. They knew the center of who they were was gone, and no doubt there was a deep lostness and despair among the people. And they needed hope. They needed people to come, and they needed to see that God was still with them. So we go on into verse 3 of chapter 1. Then the king commanded his palace master Ashpenaz to bring some of the Israelites of the royal family and of the nobility, young men without physical defect and handsome, versed in every branch of wisdom, endowed with knowledge and insight, and competent to serve in the king's palace. They were taught the literature and language of the Chaldeans. The king assigned them a daily portion of the royal rations of food and wine. They were to be educated for 3 years, so at the end of that time, they could be stationed in the king's court. Among them were Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, Azariah from the tribe of Judah. The palace master gave them other names. Daniel he called Belteshazzar, Hananiah he called Shadrach, Mishael he called Meshach, and Azariah he called Abednego. That's almost like speaking in tongues for me with reading those things. That was a lot of stuff there. So these four guys that we read about here, they came from their own land, and we read that they were noble of royalty. So they had some class, they had some prestige, they were upper class, if we could call them that. And they're brought into Babylon by the king, and the palace master changes their names. Now, the Bible doesn't say this, but I think that is an act of humiliation to me. You know, if I was pulled from South Whitley and brought down here to Huntington County and you guys, you know, gave me a new name, you're not Joel anymore, you're going to be called Jolene. You know, that would, well, that's cool now, you know, we can do that. But I would be humiliated by that a little bit. You know, just the fact that they took me from my home, they took me from my place and gave me this new identity. There's an element of humiliation there. And we're brought to hone the skills and gifts that these guys, they already had those, but they're fine-tuning these in order to serve a different king, one that was different than the ones they would have had back home in Judea. And that would have been, I believe, a very humiliating thing for all of the people, especially these four who are central to this story. Some of the last people to leave, you know, this breaking up of Israel started in 722 BC, and now we're at 587, 597, depending on when. The last ones that are exiled are being exiled. A few were left behind to tend the vineyards, Scripture tells us, and to tend the land. But they would have been the last ones of the people that would have represented all of the people that was given this awesome land to be used by them through God to fulfill His purpose. And they would have remembered. They would have remembered what their ancestors told them, that you're going to be given this land flowing of milk and honey to do His great work. We are the people of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. These would be the memories that the people during Daniel's time would have been thinking about. But we'll find out that God didn't abandon His people. He didn't leave Himself without a witness to these other nations. And that's what we're going to find out. These four guys are going to turn out to be ambassadors of God in this other nation that serves other gods and does other kinds of living that the people shouldn't live. And so we see God's hand begin to work throughout the story of Daniel. And you know some of these stories, some of these great things that God does. You know, get thrown in a den of lions and what happens. And you get thrown in a fiery furnace and what happens. And the dreams that come and need to be interpreted. We'll get to some of these here in the next few weeks. But God is using these ambassadors among this foreign nation to help encourage His people of hope that are living there, that He's still got this. Those people that would have been in such despair would know He's still in control. He uses all of these circumstances that the nation finds themselves in to accomplish His will. That's just what we know about God. He will use whatever means He can to achieve His will. So these people, they're physically far from home. They're spiritually far from God. He uses people to once again to reveal Himself and accomplish His purpose and His ways for His good and for His glory. So these guys, they're chosen. They're the elites of Judah to be used and be trained up in the ways of the current people, the current culture, the Chaldeans, the Babylonians, for service to another king. I don't know what I'd be thinking if I was there, but it's just, it'd be a difficult, difficult time. And so then they are presented. These guys, these four, along with a number of other people, are brought in this 3-year training service to be brought up in the ways of the people to be used by King Nebuchadnezzar. And they're given the royal choice food, it says, to ensure that their bodies are kept at their peak. But listen what happens. You know, these guys are kind of brought in. They're probably sort of treated like royalty a little bit. And they're given this good stuff. But watch how they respond in verse 8. Daniel resolved that he would not defile himself with the royal rations of food and wine. So he asked the palace master to allow him not to defile himself. Now God allowed Daniel to receive favor and compassion from the palace master. The palace master said to Daniel, "I am afraid of my lord the king. He's appointed your food and your drink. If he should see you in poorer condition than the other young men of your own age, you would endanger my head with the king." Okay, I get that. You know, he's kind of worried about his own neck here. "I was given a job to give you this food. I'd kind of like to live through this," the palace master says. So Daniel asked the guard whom the palace master had appointed over Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah, "Please test your servants for 10 days. Let us be given vegetables to eat and water to drink. You can then compare the appearance compare our appearance with the appearance of the young men who eat the royal rations and deal with your servants according to what you observe." So Daniel wants, and his three friends, you know, they want to do the right thing. They don't want to defile themselves, and they want to do things differently. "Just give us vegetables and water. And here, test. Let's see how this works." And that tells you a little bit about the character and the integrity of these men, that under these circumstances, they chose to do that. And it talks, too, about their commitment to their real king, not Nebuchadnezzar. Verse 14 goes on and says, "So we agreed to this proposal and tested them for 10 days. At the end of 10 days, it was observed that they appeared better and fatter than all the young men who had been eating the royal rations. So the guard continued to withdraw their royal rations and the wine they were to drink and gave them vegetables. To these four young men, God gave knowledge and skill in every aspect of literature and wisdom. Daniel also had insight into all visions and dreams. At the end of the time that the king had set for them to be brought in, and the palace master brought them into the presence of Nebuchadnezzar, and the king spoke to them with them. And among them, no one was found to compare with Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah. Therefore, they were stationed in the king's court. In every matter of wisdom and understanding concerning which the court inquired of them, in which the king inquired of them, he found them 10 times better than all the magicians and enchanters in the whole kingdom. And Daniel continued there until the first year of King Cyrus. So God's going to use these people. He's going to bless these people for his service, even though they're in a foreign land under a different kind of government and in a culture that lives far differently than what they're called to live as people of God. They're physically far from where they are supposed to be, far from the center of where it is that they are supposed to practice their religion. But still, Daniel and his friends choose to maintain their integrity and not be defiled by anything that would be unclean according to the law that they live by. Boy, they're committed and they're people of high character and integrity. They choose not to participate in the customs of the land that they find themselves in because it would defile them. Evidence of their level of faith and commitment. He still chooses to operate under the law that they're supposed to live under. The law that we know is found in Deuteronomy and Leviticus that Daniel would have been so familiar with. We don't know what was in the royal rations that Daniel chose not to be a part of. There were some things that they weren't allowed to eat. I was thinking about this on the way over, and God chooses everybody to do different things, and he didn't choose me to be in a situation like this because I would have failed. Because I would have saw something there that looks pretty good. Yesterday, my brother had a party for his people that he lives around there, and he did a seafood boil. You ever been to one of those? Oh, it was awesome. There's corn and there's potatoes and there's shrimp and there's sausage, and I crashed that party. He kept telling me about it over the phone. I didn't have anything to do, so I drove up to Michigan last night and had that, because I need something like that, and I'm kind of weak there. And so if I'm Daniel, probably what would have happened here, I would have saw some shrimp wrapped bacon there and said, yeah, because that definitely would have been something that would have defiled him, because we know in Jewish law that seafood, that kind of seafood, shellfish, nope, can't do. Bacon comes from a pig, nope, can't do. Joel would have failed there, so he picked Daniel instead. Good move. So we don't know what it was. It was probably something like that. It probably was a food that would have been deemed as unclean for people to practice the laws of the Jewish people. Wine in itself isn't unclean. That's not something that Scripture talks about at the time that is prohibitive in any way. In fact, wine oftentimes is used as a good thing, and it represents joy among the people. So wine by itself isn't unclean. And so some scholars think that perhaps Daniel and his buddies during that time took it's called a Nazarite vow, where no alcohol is not partaken of people for a period of time. Is sort of a fasting kind of thing. So perhaps that's what happens here, and that's why they chose to have water instead. But regardless, what has happened here is they made this spiritual decision to stay true to their God in the best way that they could for that particular purpose. There is this urge, I believe, for people to get back to the old way, the way things used to be, a way of life that was in the past. And for these people during this time, Daniel and his friends, no doubt, but all of the other people that would have been exiled away from their homeland would want to get back to the good old days. And it's a real need and it's a real feeling. But I think those folks that were exiled and kept under captivity from a different leader. I think what would have been revealed to them is what was really missed, what was missed the most. Because what the people needed and what they really missed and what they were really hoping for was not a way of life, but rather it was the presence of God. That's what was missing among the people at that time. Because when they lived in Judea, when they were back in Israel, the temple that had the picture up there before, that was central to the people. It was center of their life. It was center of their politics. It was the center of their culture. And it was the center of their religion. And the reason for that is God's real presence resided in that temple, in that Holy of Holies, where that Ark of the Covenant was. Scripture calls it the Shekinah glory. The glory of the Lord was there. They were in the real presence of the Lord. And so what had been taken away, it wasn't so much the gold and the stuff and the things, but what was broken, what was taken away, and what the real loss of the people was the presence of God. That was their most basic need, to be in His presence. And in their heart of hearts, that's what they would have missed the most when they were in exile. I think that's really where the story makes a great parallel with our lives and where you and I are, communities, and in our culture as well. You know, we can talk about wanting to get back to those good old days and another way of life that we would probably say was better. You know, back to where behaviors weren't like they are today. There was a higher level of morality. There was a time where we would think that people treated people more respectfully than they do today. A lifestyle, a way of life, back to the good old days. But similarly to Israel in the captivity, those things are really a byproduct of that which is really missing among us. Because if there's really anything missing, I believe, in our culture today, it's really more people who possess that nearness of God. More people who have submitted their lives to Christ and entrusted their lives through faith by living in the forgiveness of the cross. To have that real presence within them, the all-powerful God that resides in them. That's what we're missing. It isn't a lifestyle. It's not a way of life. It's not the good old days. We're missing more people to be true followers of Christ, whose all of life and all of character and all of integrity are influenced by the Holy Spirit within them. That's hope. That's the hope that's reflected in the book of Daniel, and that's the hope you and I have. As John read this morning, that this treasure that's in these earthen vessels that we have, that's Christ in us, the great mystery that Paul talks about. That is what is missing. When more of our community and more of our country and more of our world contain people who are true followers of Christ, we'll begin to see those kinds of changes that we think we're missing the most. It's really less about getting back to a particular way of life, and it's much more about getting our particular lives centered on Him. And those kinds of changes only happen through great community churches like this one. Let's keep working. Will you stand and we will close with prayer. Father, I just continue to thank You for Your Word and the preciousness of Bibles that are so prevalent today in our culture, that we have that which You have preserved for so long. Stories of people 2,500 years ago that impact our lives today. We thank You for the story of Daniel and those faithful people that represented You in a dark, dark time. We pray for this church as we would consider our lives, as we are the light to our culture, just as Daniel and his friends were to the culture of their time. Strengthen us by Your Spirit that we may go and be hungry for You, into Your Word, and being the kinds of loving, caring people that this dark world needs to see. It's in Jesus' great name. Amen. Have a great week.